Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Yearning, Race, Gender, and Cultural Politics, Second Edition, by Bell Hooks, narrated by Adenrele Ojo. Preface to the New Edition. Even though I had been writing cultural criticism for magazines for years, Yearning was the first book-length compilation of my work. Putting the diverse essays in this collection together was exciting, because it allowed me to express the range of my theoretical interests. Writing about popular culture, I could engage the intersections between race, class, and gender. Moreover, I had discovered in classroom settings and while giving public lectures that using a visual text, film, art, or television as the base by which to talk about race and gender engaged folks. No matter race, class, gender, everyone seemed to have ideas and ways of thinking about visual narratives that served as a catalyst for a meaningful discussion. Focusing critique on cultural productions opened a space for education for a critical consciousness that could serve as a pedagogy of liberation, both in the academy and in the larger society. Unlike feminist theory and practice, which ultimately demanded commitment to feminist politics, and an overall change in society, which was experienced as dangerous and threatening, cultural criticism allowed for a more democratic discourse. Although much critique was written from a progressive or radical perspective, it did not have a radical militant agenda as its core foundation. Unlike feminist theory, which was emerging from a more abstract discussion of what it means to challenge patriarchy and create new cultural paradigms, cultural criticism approached from a feminist standpoint could engage audiences more directly by allowing everyone a space to engage in radical critique. And most importantly, it could allow audiences to recognize the interconnectedness of systems of domination. Nowadays, it is cool to talk about intersectionality, the overlapping of systems like racism, sexism, class elitism. However, interconnectedness is a more vital way of framing the discourse, in that it serves as a constant reminder that we cannot change one aspect of the system without changing the whole. Certainly in the area of race and representation, it became evident that cultural producers might create a work that was progressive in its articulation of an anti-racist agenda, while relying on sexist stereotypes to give audiences familiar tropes, thus rendering the work less threatening. As a critic, I hoped to use cultural criticism to aid in our effort to end domination and oppression in all its forms. This focus allows for an inclusive standpoint where one is not required to choose gender over race or vice versa, where there is not demand that issues of class and sexuality be left out of discussions for fear that radical thinking will be undermined. Radical visionary cultural criticism aims to do more than deconstruct cultural production. It endeavors to call attention to alternative modes of creating, to new ways of seeing, thinking, and being. When I began to concentrate attention on cultural criticism, I was moved by its potential for inclusive focus. I began to think that just as the interconnectedness of systems of domination was a necessary standpoint from which to critique cultural production, it also led me to think deeply about ways we are all connected across race, class, gender, sexuality, and religion. To build solidarity in our struggles to end domination and oppression, it seemed vital to call attention to shared humanity. And one location of that unity was present in our emotional universe. For across all differences of race, gender, class, sexuality, religion, was a shared realm of emotional feeling. Thinking about shared passions and longing, I thought about all of us who were and are committed to remaining critically aware. I thought of our passionate collective longing for peace and justice. Thinking that our yearning might serve as a uniting force, I wanted to make the longing of our hearts tied to the quest for freedom. The most essential aspect of this collection is its call to all of us to link personal passion and political quest. Women yearn for change and will make great sacrifices for it. Lydia. A Dream Compels Us, Voices of Salvadoran Women. In this world-weary period of perversive cynicisms, nihilisms, terrorisms, and possible extermination, there is a longing for norms and values that can make a difference, a yearning for principled resistance and struggle that can change our desperate plight. Cornell West, The American Evasion of Philosophy. I was moved by violent conflicts and yearnings, a need to be reassured in love that all but obscured any expression of loving. Robert Duncan. It was gentlemen, after a long absence, 7 years to be exact, during which time I was studying in Europe, that I returned to my people. I learnt much and much passed me by, but that is another story. The important thing is that I return with a great yearning for my people in that small village at the bend of the Nile. For 7 years, I had longed for them, had dreamed of them, and it was an extraordinary moment when I at last found myself standing amongst them. They rejoiced at having me back and made a great fuss, and it was not long before I felt as though a piece of ice were melting inside of me, as though I were some frozen substance on which the sun had shone. That life warmth of tribe, which I had lost for a time. Taib Saleh, Season of Migration to the North. 1. Liberation Scenes. Speak This Yearning. Lorraine Hansberry's play, A Raisin in the Sun, was recently made into a film and shown to a mass audience on the PBS series American Playhouse. Opening on Broadway in 1959, it was a first. Lorraine Hansberry was the youngest American playwright, the fifth woman, the only black writer, and of course, the first black woman writer to win the New York Drama Critics Circle Award for Best Play of the Year. When it was first produced, A Raisin in the Sun was in many ways a counter-hegemonic cultural production. The play interrogated the fear within black people that being out of our place, not conforming to social norms, especially those set by white supremacy, would lead to destruction, even death. On a basic level, the play was about housing, the way racial segregation in a capitalist society meant that black folks were discriminated against when seeking places to live. It made it clear that the younger family was not interested in being a part of a white culture in assimilation. They wanted better housing. As counter-hegemonic cultural production, the play A Raisin in the Sun was full of contradictions. Though anti-assimilationist, it evoked the possibility of moving from one set of class values to another, working-class people aspiring to middle-class lifestyles. The play promises that the traditional black folk culture and value system, epitomized and expressed by Mama, will be maintained in the new location. These are the values that lead Mama to ask Walter Lee, who thinks about a capitalist materialist sense of success, since when did money become life? Warning against rooting one's sense of identity, culture, and value in materialism, Mama reminds her family that black people survived the Holocaust of slavery because they had oppositional ways of thinking, ones that were different from the structures of domination determining so much of their lives. Critiques of materialism were crucial for Black people seeking to preserve dignity in a rapidly developing consumer capitalist world. It is that world Walter Lee wants to join. His desire to take the insurance money and buy a liquor store links consumer capitalism with the production of a world of addiction. With visionary foresight, Hansberry suggests the possibility that substances, alcohol, drugs, etc., and substance abuse threaten Black solidarity, acting as a genocidal force in the Black community. In retrospect, A Raisin in the Sun prophetically hinted at the way consumer capitalism and racial integration would, in the near future, transform the lives of Black people. Walter Lee, as potential advanced capitalist monster, consumed as he is by desire for material things, symbolically represents the possible fate of poor Black people in contemporary culture. He is saved by Mama and old world values. Walter Lee is consumed by yearning. His longing for money, goods, power, and control over his destiny made him symbolic of the Black American underclass in the 50s and early 60s. Ironically, when the play reached a contemporary public in the 80s, Walter Lee, played by Danny Glover, was portrayed as a crazed, angry, dangerous Black man. Gone was Walter Lee's symbolic representation of collective Black yearning. In his place stood the isolated Black male terrorist, an image which lived up to a white audience's racist notions of contemporary Black masculinity. I was stunned by the way in which the contemporary revisioning of Hansberry's play made it no longer a counter-hegemonic cultural production, but a work that fit with popular racist stereotypes of Black masculinity as dangerous, threatening, etc. Attempting to make this play accessible to a predominantly white mass audience, the work was altered so that the interpretation of specific roles would correspond with prefabricated notions of Black identity, particularly Black male identity. A powerful example of the way in which contemporary commodification of Black culture strips work of the potential to be counter-hegemonic, this production received little critical attention. Even though it was trashed and critiqued in any number of personal conversations engaged in by Black artists and intellectuals, no one made it the subject for extensive public cultural critique. Whenever a work by a Black writer receives attention, acclaim, or recognition in mainstream cultural circles these days, Black critics rarely respond with harsh critique. Or in the case of a drama like Driving Miss Daisy, created by a white writer with a major role for a Black actor, the tacit assumption seems to be that since the success of this play, which also became a film, catapulted Black actors into greater stardom, it was above critical reproach. Again, it was easier for Black artists and intellectuals to challenge the sentimentalizing of race relations in this rather boring status quo cultural production and conversation among ourselves. Folks could admit to having been moved by the sentimental drama of Driving Miss Daisy in the same way some Black viewers are touched by Gone with the Wind, even though politically they recognize the way the reproduction of cultural products which encourage and romanticize race relations that are rooted in domination dangerously undermines efforts to create critical consciousness of the need to eradicate racism. Cultural criticism has historically functioned in Black life as a force promoting critical resistance, one that enabled Black folks to cultivate in everyday life a practice of critique and analysis that would disrupt and even deconstruct those cultural productions that were designed to promote and reinforce domination. In other words, a poor Black family, like the one I was raised in, might sit around watching Amos and Andy, enjoying it even as we simultaneously critiqued it, talking about the ways this cultural production served the interests of white supremacy. We knew we were not watching representations of ourselves created by black artists or progressive white folks. Within the context of an apartheid social structure where practically every aspect of black life was determined by the efforts of those in power to maintain white supremacy, black folks were incredibly vigilant. Not only was there in black life an obsessive concern with racial uplift, doing all that was necessary to improve the quality of black life, there was an ongoing recognition of the need to oppose and denounce representations of blackness created by racist white folks. When we sat in our living rooms in the 50s and early 60s, watching those few black folks who appeared on television screens, we talked about their performance, but we always talked about the way the white folks were treating them. I have vivid memories of watching the Ed Sullivan Show on Sunday nights, of seeing on that show the great Louis Armstrong. Daddy, who was usually silent, would talk about the music, the way Armstrong was being treated, and the political implications of his appearance. Watching television in the 50s and 60s and listening to adult conversation was one of the primary ways many young black folks learned about race politics. Another vivid memory that comes to mind is watching Imitation of Life with my five sisters, one of the first screen dramas that linked issues of race, gender, and sexuality. Participating in household discussions about these works, many of us developed critical consciousness about the politics of race. Responding to televised cultural production, black people could express rage about racism as it informed representation, the construction of images. Then there was no passive consumption of images. How indeed could black viewers passively consume a film like Birth of a Nation when we lived daily with the threat of lynchings and the reality of racial murder? How could little black girls growing to womanhood in a segregated South so charged with sexualized violence, you knew every time you walked from your mama's place to your grandmama's to avoid any direct eye contact with white men in cars, and not to be caught in any secluded place alone with white men because you might be raped, not feel the sexual terrorism that is an underlying tension in Imitation of Life? Our gaze was not passive. The screen was not a place of escape. It was a place of confrontation and encounter. No one has studied enough the extent to which racial interrogation changed black response to the culture industry and to cultural production. That collective critical black gaze, developed in the context of resistance to overt racist discrimination and racial violence, was altered in the late 60s and 70s as barriers were crossed and white folks behind the scenes of mass media, particularly television and film, suddenly realized that despite racism, perhaps even because of racial taboos, white viewers would, in fact, not only accept the presence of black images on the screen, but actually be captivated by them. Media coverage of black civil rights struggles, the black power movement, race riots, and the like made for exciting news. Violence was on the screen in living color, in a way that captured the attention of mass audiences. Black images were commodified as never before in history. Unfortunately, all that counter-hegemonic cultural criticism that had been honed and developed in black living rooms, kitchens, barbershops, and beauty parlors did not surface in a different form. Black folks were not engaged in writing a body of critical cultural analysis that would keep pace with the proliferation of images. The primary form that black cultural criticism took was the question of good or bad images. This critical response corresponded with a political emphasis on reform. If the goal of reform-oriented black liberation struggle was equality within existing societal structures, then it followed that there would be passive acceptance of the commodification of Black cultural life as long as the images produced were seen as good or positive. And that would be determined by whether or not the images created were seen as helping to bring about racial inclusion in the mainstream. Placing cultural critique by Black critics solely in the reformist realm of debate about good and bad images effectively silenced more complex critical dialogue. No wonder, then, that there has not been, until very recently, concern about creating cultural spaces wherein larger numbers of Black thinkers can be encouraged to do cultural critique. Current emphasis on the development of cultural studies in academic settings, as well as the production of more and more publications that are willing to publish diverse perspectives on culture, is helping create a climate where more Black artists and intellectuals can do cultural criticism. Changes in Black responses to media created by consumer capitalism, we are a much more passive audience these days, must be talked about. If we are to understand the ways Black liberation struggles and, most particularly, the decolonizing of our minds is affected by media. In the introduction to Cultural Politics in Contemporary America, Ian Angus and Sutjali offer powerful reasons cultural critiques must confront the power of representations as they affect the formation of social identity. In contemporary culture, the media have become central to the constitution of social identity. It is not just that media messages have become important forms of influence on individuals. We also identify and construct ourselves as social beings through the mediation of images. This is not simply a case of people being dominated by images, but of people seeking and obtaining pleasure through the experience of the consumption of these images. An understanding of contemporary culture involves a focus on both the phenomenology of watching and the cultural form of images. Within Black communities, fundamental changes in conceptions of social identity occurred after the 70s. The collective critical Black gaze that was central to an orally transmitted cultural politics of resistance was fundamentally altered. Replaced by an ethic in complete contradiction to those values stressed by Mama in A Raisin in the Sun, the emphasis was on finding work for Black folks in the culture industry. And if indeed that work was well paid, then that would override any need to question the politics underlying certain representations. Cultural critique is particularly relevant to Black artists and/or intellectuals who see ourselves as committed to an ongoing Black liberation struggle with a central emphasis on decolonization. Education for critical consciousness is the most important task before us. Working in the academy, as many of us do, it is through a liberatory pedagogy that we make useful critical intervention. Two important spaces for the transmission of our ideas are writing and speaking. In college and university settings, meeting the demands of one's profession often makes it difficult to do work that is fundamentally an expression of radical political commitment. Many academics involved with cultural studies do not see their work as emerging from an oppositional, progressive cultural politic that seeks to link theory and practice, that has as its most central agenda sharing knowledge and information in ways that transform how we think about our social reality. Witnessing colleagues who are indifferent to the concrete needs of marginalized groups claim cultural studies as their privileged domain is disconcerting and potentially disillusioning. However, it does not cause me to despair, because I see the power of progressive cultural criticism in the classroom setting and recognize that location as a crucial site for critical intervention. Therefore, it would be a grave mistake to abandon the field to those thinkers who are primarily concerned with professional advancement. I have found that students are much more engaged when they are learning how to think critically and analytically by exploring concrete aspects of their reality, particularly their experience of popular culture. Teaching theory, I find that students may understand a particular paradigm in the abstract, but are unable to see how to apply it to their lives. Focusing on popular culture has been one of the main ways to bridge this gap. When Spike Lee's film, Do the Right Thing, was initially shown, Black students studying feminist theory with me, who had begun to apply a feminist analysis rooted in an understanding of race and class, felt conflicted. They enjoyed the film, but were disturbed by aspects of the work. Black male students came to talk with me, bringing their buddies, because they were in conflict over their different interpretations of the film. They were deeply concerned with the issue of whether negative critique meant they were not supportive of a brother, i.e., Spike Lee, who is trying to make it and be in solidarity with blackness. Also, they feared that disagreement among themselves might disrupt feelings of racial bonding and solidarity. Again, as we educate one another to acquire critical consciousness, we have the chance to see how important airing diverse perspectives can be for any progressive political struggle that is serious about transformation. Engaging in intellectual exchange, where people hear a diversity of viewpoints, enables them to witness firsthand solidarity that grows stronger in a context of productive critical exchange and confrontation. One issue that surfaces when teaching the skills of radical cultural critique to students is a sense of conflict between pleasure and analysis. Initially, they often assume that if you are critiquing a subject, it must mean that you do not like it. Since I have written critical essays on two Spike Lee films, students will often say, "Hey, you're really down on Spike." Or even before they get on my case, if I express a positive interest in Lee's work, they are surprised because they assume that the critical essays are an attack. In any liberatory pedagogy, students should learn how to distinguish between hostile critique that is about trashing and critique that's about illuminating and enriching our understanding. Critiques that offer critical insight without serving as a barrier to appreciation are necessary if Black folks are to develop cultural products that will not be simply received, accepted, and applauded because of tokenism, a gesture which simply reinforces paternalistic notions of white supremacy. The notion that cultural criticism by Black folks must either be confined to the question of positive or negative representation or function in a self-serving manner, that is, if you are talking about a work by a Black person, then you must say something positive or risk being silenced, must be continually challenged. Recently, a filmmaker friend called me to say he had seen several anthologies of writing by Black women on feminism, and even those with Black female editors did not include my work. He could not understand how my work could be excluded from works advertised as giving a critical overview. I responded by sharing that folks often do not like what I'm saying or the style of presentation, and make that known by ignoring my work. Certainly, one of the primary dangers arising from the reality that much critical and creative writing by Black folks emerges from those of us housed in the academy is that the university is basically a politically conservative framework, which often inhibits the production of diverse perspectives, new ideas, and different styles of thinking and writing. At times, individual Black folks who have gained power in the academy assume the role of secret police, guarding ideas and work to make sure nothing is said that contradicts the status quo. Teaching and writing about the work of Black women writers, I often meet tremendous resistance from students and colleagues when I suggest that we must do more than express positive appreciation for this work. that to engage it critically in a rigorous way is more a gesture of respect than is passive acceptance. When I ask students to think critically about the machinery of cultural production, how work is advertised, reviewed, disseminated, etc., as it affects the current focus on Black women writers, connecting these processes to the commodification of Blackness, they are often disturbed. They want to see the current focus on Black women writers solely in positive terms. They find it difficult to consider the possibility that work is not necessarily oppositional because it is created by a Black person, that it may not necessarily offer a non-racist or non-sexist perspective. This desire to simplify one's critical response, to contain it within a dualistic model of good and bad, accepted and rejected, is an approach to ways of knowing that a liberatory pedagogy seeks to alter. Even though Western metaphysical dualism, as a paradigmatic philosophical approach, provides the logical framework for structures of domination in this society, race, gender, class exploitation, individuals from oppressed and exploited groups internalize this way of thinking, inverting it. For example, some Black people may reject the assumptions of white supremacy and replace them with notions of Black superiority. Assuming such a standpoint, they may feel threatened by any critical approach that does not reinforce this perspective. Cultural critics who are committed to a radical cultural politics, especially those of us who teach students from exploited and oppressed groups, must offer theoretical paradigms in a manner that connects them to contextualized political strategies. For me, critical pedagogy, expressed in writing, teaching, and habits of being, is fundamentally linked to a concern with creative strategies that will enable colonized folks to decolonize their minds and actions, thereby promoting the insurrection of subjugated knowledge. Trendy cultural critique that is in no way linked to a concern with critical pedagogy or liberation struggles hinders this process. When white critics write about Black culture because it's the in subject, without interrogating their work to see whether or not it helps perpetuate and maintain racist domination, they participate in the commodification of Blackness that is so peculiar to postmodern strategies of colonization. Jolly and Angus define postmodern culture as a society where social identity is formed through mass-mediated images and where culture and economy have merged to form a single sphere. There is too little work which seeks to examine the impact of postmodernism on contemporary Black culture. An oppositional cultural politic has always informed transformative Black liberation struggle. More than ever before, cultural criticism that can illuminate and enrich our understanding of the social formation of Black identity, the commodification of Blackness, is needed. It will not emerge solely from Black critics, but from all cultural critics who are concerned with the eradication of racism. Within the field of cultural criticism, there are very few African-American voices speaking out. There are more Black voices, some from Europe and many from third world countries. When these critics write about Black American culture, they offer a valuable perspective, one that differs from that of African Americans. Hence, they do not replace absent or silenced African American voices. Trendy notions of difference that lump all people of color together without distinguishing perspectives can serve to mask the absence of an African American presence in the field of cultural studies. Cultural critics, especially those of us who are Black, seeking to make a context for a critical intervention that is linked with strategies for liberation, cannot ignore the issue of representation as it determines who gets to speak to, with, and for us about culture and be heard, with legitimacy, as cultural studies is more solidly institutionalized and commodified. As I have already stated, cultural criticism is often the subject that most engages students in the classroom. There, it is clear who the audience is and the impact on that audience. This is less the case with published cultural criticism. To avoid participating in the production of cultural criticism as a hot commodity to be exchanged in the academic marketplace, cultural critics can make an effort to publish work in places, magazines, newspapers, etc., where it will potentially reach a different audience. Certainly, it's important for cultural critics to seize all opportunities to engage in oral dialogues and conversations with audiences outside the academy. If there is not a mutual exchange between the cultural subjects, African Americans, for example, that are written about, and the critics who write about them, a politic of domination is easily reproduced, wherein intellectual elites assume an old colonizing role, that of privileged interpreter, cultural overseers. Entering the university as a writer concerned with acquiring credentials that would help me get a job, I am constantly aware of the way our very location in an academic setting, where one's work is periodically reviewed, judged, evaluated, etc., informs what we write about and how we write. On one hand, cultural studies has made writing about non-white culture more acceptable, particularly in the humanities. Yet, on the other hand, this work does not emerge within a context that necessarily stresses the need to approach these subjects with a progressive politics or a liberatory pedagogy. Therein lies the danger. Cultural studies could easily become the space for the informers, those folks who appear to be allied with the disadvantaged, the oppressed, who are either spies or there to mediate between the forces of domination and its victims. Vigilant insistence that cultural studies be linked to a progressive radical cultural politics will ensure that it is a location that enables critical intervention. Ironically, though Black writers and/or scholars have always been engaged in writing cultural criticism, the way it has been constituted as a new field of discourse in the academy tends to overlook these contributions or, when they are recognized, they tend to be devalued. The most productive response by Black critics has to be the continued production of material and an ongoing expressed willingness to engage the discourse of cultural criticism on all fronts. This collection of essays, Yearning, Race, Gender, and Culture, is the outcome of involvement with cultural criticism. Reading work by cultural critics both in and outside the academy, I was deeply troubled by the paucity of material by African American women. Given current interest in fiction by Black women writers, it is telling that there is not a corresponding desire to hear from us what we think about cultural production. Folks may be familiar with Michelle Wallace's insightful cultural criticism, but they may not have read the essays of Hortense Spillers, Valerie Smith, Coco Fusco, or Lisa Jones, to name a few. Cultural studies and cultural criticism excite me because they are the obvious location for work that is interdisciplinary for feminist theory that seeks to combine multiple perspectives, for work that is written from a standpoint that includes analysis of race and class. Some of the essays written for this collection were first published in Z Magazine, yet the inspiration to write them usually came from concrete intellectual exchange in everyday life. Reluctant to see Spike Lee's film, Do the Right Thing, because the way in which it was advertised seemed like such a setup, viewers were already being told what we should see when we watched the film, I had no desire to write about it. Finally, seeing it after the fuss had subsided, I was determined not to write about it. When students and friends pleaded with me to respond to this film, to give them a critical framework that could serve as a catalyst, pushing them to think deeply about the work, I responded spontaneously in endless conversations, then by writing my thoughts. Writing cultural criticism as a response to engaged dialogue with friends, colleagues, and students is different from writing a piece so that it will enhance one's list of publications for a tenure process or any other process of academic evaluation. Since many of the white men with power in the institution where I teach loved Do the Right Thing, I was aware that being public and writing about my thoughts could possibly have negative consequences. Black thinkers and writers in the academy, like all other marginalized groups, are constantly subjected to scrutiny. Often colleagues read my work and arbitrarily conclude that she hates white people. I share this so that folks can have some idea of why black scholars find it sometimes difficult to write, in whatever manner we choose, about everything we want to write about. And the same holds true for black cultural critics who are not in the academy. If you are trying to publish anything, book, article, review, etc., usually there is a white hierarchy determining who will edit one's work. I did a piece recently on teaching women's studies courses to black students. When it was returned to me edited, I noticed that all the critical comments about white women feminists had been deleted. We produce cultural criticism in the context of white supremacy. At times, even the most progressive and well-meaning white folks, who are friends and allies, may not understand why a black writer has to say something a certain way, or why we may not want to explain what has been said as though the first people we must always be addressing are privileged white readers. While writing these essays, I consciously thought about the process of decolonization, of what happens when black people begin to decolonize our minds, right from that perspective, and then turn work over to editors and publishers who may not have a clue as to what we are trying to say or who may try to rearrange the work so it says something else. Riding home from the movie theater after seeing Usain Palsy's film, A Dry White Season, with my best buddy from childhood, I tried to describe the thoughts and feelings that welled up in me as I watched the film, yet found myself unable to articulate them clearly. After moments of violent weeping came a screaming rage about the way Western contexts of covert censorship, white supremacy, the academy, make it hard to say what you really want to say. And every black writer knows that the people you may most want to hear your words may never read them, that many of them have never learned to read. Finally, I found words to talk and write about this film, words lacking some of the fire I initially felt, though sparks remain. I share the background drama that lies behind some of these essays because I am always astounded by the fact that no amount of writing makes the difficulties of expression any less painful. Years ago, I heard a Cuban writer, Edmundo de Noy, talk about the obsession citizens of the United States have with the issue of censorship in communist countries. There was little comment when it was pointed out that censorship takes place in this society in more subtle forms, a primary one being the process of editing and/or rejecting manuscripts. Often radical writers doing transgressive work are told not that it's too political or too left, but simply that it will not sell or readers just will not be interested in that perspective. When I wrote the essay on Looking for Langston, Isaac Julian's latest film, I was not thinking about who would publish it, annoyed that so much of what little was said about this work in the press did not give it serious regard. I wanted to express the way I experienced the film. When I sent this piece to Z, I enclosed a note saying that I realized it was not written in the style they think is most accessible to their readers. But I wanted to give readers this critical mediation on the film, even if it seemed too poetic, too dreamy for Z. The note was really a plea for them to publish it as is, without change. Being a worker in the academy, I can steal time to write long essays that may not be published anywhere. One reason more Black writers are not doing cultural criticism is that it's hard to find time to write essays that might never make any money or be published. Certainly, this is so for writers who are trying to make a living selling their work. And the extent to which writers are trying to sell work to pay the bills often determines their willingness to submit to undesired edits. It's a struggle sometimes. Unlike other she-she collections on cultural criticism, Yearning includes feminist essays on race and gender. Writing about film and television, I now have readers who boldly tell me they just are not interested in that feminist stuff or that race thing. Several essays in this collection discuss the way in which cultural criticism is at times seen as a way to get away from approaching subjects from a clearly politicized standpoint. Critics Cornel West, Greg Tate, Lawrence Grossberg, Andrew Ross, Michelle Wallace, Jane Gaines, to randomly name a few, who see no need to separate politics from the pleasure of reading a work intensely and critically, celebrate the coexistence of these concerns. Certainly, I am most excited about writing and reading cultural criticism that is linked with a concern for transforming oppressive structures of domination. That's the kind of work I want to do, both as artist and critic. Lastly, I gathered this group of essays under the heading Yearning because I looked for common passions, sentiments shared by folks across race, class, gender, and sexual practice. I was struck by the depths of longing in many of us. Those without money long to find a way to get rid of the endless sense of deprivation. Those with money wonder why so much feels so meaningless and long to find the sight of meaning. Witnessing the genocidal ravages of drug addiction in Black families and communities, I began to hear that longing for a substance as, in part, a displacement for the longed-for liberation, the freedom to control one's destiny. All too often, our political desire for change is seen as separate from longings and passions that consume lots of time and energy in daily life. Particularly, the realm of fantasy is often seen as completely separate from politics. Yet I think of all the time Black folks, especially the underclass, spend just fantasizing about what our lives would be like if there were no racism, no white supremacy. Surely our desire for radical social change is intimately linked with the desire to experience pleasure, erotic fulfillment, and a host of other passions. Then, on the flip side, there are many individuals with race, gender, and class privilege who are longing to see the kind of revolutionary change that will end domination and oppression, even though their lives would be completely and utterly transformed. The shared space and feeling of yearning opens up the possibility of common ground where all these differences might meet and engage one another. It seemed appropriate, then, to speak this yearning. 2. The Politics of Radical Black Subjectivity. I often begin courses which focus on African American literature, and sometimes specifically Black women writers, with a declaration by Paulo Freire, which had a profound liberatory effect on my thinking. We cannot enter the struggle as objects in order to later become subjects. This statement compels reflection on how the dominated, the oppressed, the exploited make ourselves subject. How do we create an oppositional worldview, a consciousness, an identity, a standpoint that exists not only as that struggle, which also opposes dehumanization, but as that movement which enables creative, expansive self-actualization? Opposition is not enough. In that vacant space after one has resisted, there is still the necessity to become, to make oneself anew. Resistance is that struggle we can most easily grasp. Even the most subjective person has moments of rage and resentment so intense that they respond, they act against. There is an inner uprising that leads to rebellion, however short-lived. It may be only momentary, but it takes place. That space within oneself, where resistance is possible, remains. It is different than to talk about becoming subjects. That process emerges as one comes to understand how structures of domination work in one's own life, as one develops critical thinking and critical consciousness, as one invents new, alternative habits of being, and resists from that marginal space of difference inwardly defined. Retrospective examination of Black liberation struggle in the United States indicates the extent to which ideas about freedom were informed by efforts to imitate the behavior, lifestyles, and most importantly, the values and consciousness of white colonizers. Much civil rights reform reinforced the idea that Black liberation should be defined by the degree to which Black people gained equal access to material opportunities and privileges available to whites, jobs, housing, schooling, etc. And even though the more radical 1960s Black Power movement repudiated imitation of whites, emphasizing Pan-Africanist connections, their vision of liberation was not particularly distinctive or revolutionary. Certainly, the core of Black Muslim liberatory efforts also centered around gaining access to material privileges, though from the standpoint of Black self-determination and control. The kind of nation-building which would place Black men in positions of authority and power. Sexism has diminished the power of all Black liberation struggles, reformist or revolutionary. Ironically, the more radical Black nationalist liberation efforts were informed by a sexism much more severe than any present in earlier civil rights reform. The legacies of Fannie Lou Hamer, Septima Clark, Rosa Parks, Ella Baker, and many unknown Black women testify to the force of their presence, the intensity and value of their contributions to civil rights struggle. The work of Black women active in the 1960s Black Power movement was often appropriated by Black males without acknowledgement or recognition. Witness the fate of Ruby Doris Smith Robinson. An excellent article on her involvement in the struggle was published in the 1988 student supplement of SAGE, a scholarly journal on Black women. Commenting on Robinson's activism, Kathleen Cleaver suggests that she was subjected to a sexism that was fierce and unrelenting. Cleaver says, she was destroyed by the movement. Insistence on patriarchal values, on equating Black liberation with Black men gaining access to male privilege that would enable them to assert power over Black women, was one of the most significant forces undermining radical struggle. Thorough critiques of gender would have compelled leaders of Black liberation struggles to envision new strategies and to talk about Black subjectivity in a visionary manner. Writer, activist, and feminist thinker Toni Cade Bambara participated in the 1960s Black liberation struggle, outspokenly emphasizing the undermining force of sexism as it informed the overall social status of Black women, our participation in civil rights, as well as its debilitating impact on any attempt to radically revision Black subjectivity. Her essay, On the Issue of Roles, remains a forceful critique of sexism, documenting the demand for a different agenda. Bambara specifically cites as dangerous the sexist emphasis on Black female submission and silence in the name of liberation. On the roles assigned Black women, she asserts, she is being assigned an unreal role of mute servant that supposedly neutralizes the acidic tension that exists between Black men and Black women. She is being encouraged, in the name of revolution no less, to cultivate virtues that, if listed, would sound like personality traits of slaves. In other words, we are still abusing each other, aborting each other's nature, in the teeth of experiences both personal and historical that should alert us to the horror of a situation in which we profess to be about liberation but behave in a constricting manner. We rap about being correct but ignore the danger of having one half of our population regard the other with such condescension and perhaps fear that half finds it necessary to reclaim his manhood by denying her peoplehood. Perhaps we need to let go of all notions of manhood and femininity and concentrate on blackhood. We have as much, alas, to work against. The job of purging is staggering. It perhaps takes less heart to pick up the gun than to face the task of creating a new identity, a self, perhaps an androgynous self, via commitment to the struggle. Unfortunately, the 1960s conflict over the issue of gender roles was not fruitfully debated and resolved. Collectively, black women and men did not begin to move in a direction challenging sexist norms. Contemporary feminist movement has not yet had revolutionary impact on black political thinking. Politically, black men continue to assume dominant leadership roles, rarely, if ever, paying lip service to the need for a change in thinking about gender. Even when Jesse Jackson emphasized gender issues in his recent campaign, his comments were most often perceived as being addressed to a white female constituency. Many Jesse Jackson supporters were black women, yet he never made any specific appeals to gender concerns that deeply affect our future, issues of poverty and childcare. Black male and female refusal to consider the importance of eradicating sexism has ongoing negative consequences for black solidarity. On the cultural scene, a visible split has emerged between many black men and women, one that suggests our concerns are not similar, that we do not share a common ground where we can engage in critical dialogue about aesthetics, gender, feminist politics, etc. Viewers of the much-talked-about play The Colored Museum cannot fail to note that much of the black cultural production that is ridiculed and mocked either represents black female concerns or refers to creative work by black women artists. Cultural examples that position black women and men in an ongoing adversarial relationship can be seen in critical responses to Alice Walker's book, The Color Purple, in Stanley Crouch's scathing comments on Toni Morrison's Beloved, and in discussions of Spike Lee's films She's Gotta Have It and School Days. The latter contrasts two black males' engagement with male bonding via involvement in global politics and sexist dehumanization of a black female as initiation rite which enables affirmation of black power and brotherhood. Then there are the plays of August Wilson. Fences poignantly portrays complex negative contradictions within black masculinity in a white supremacist social context. However, patriarchy is not critiqued, and even though tragic expressions of conventional masculinity are evoked, sexist values are reinscribed via the black woman's redemption message as the play ends. Examples of brutal conflict between black women and men abound in black women's fiction. The Women of Brewster Place, The Bluest Eye, The Third Life of Grange Copeland, which highlights gender roles, especially the sexism of black male characters. Then there is the literary response to that representation. Works like Ishmael Reed's novel, Reckless Eyeballing, and most recently, Trey Ellis's Platitudes. Many of the works I have cited in no way represent counter-hegemonic cultural practice. In some cases, the veiled political agendas affirmed in particular works are reactionary and conservative. Blackness does not mean that we are inherently oppositional. Our creative work is shaped by a market that reflects white supremacist values and concerns. It should be obvious to anyone writing in this social context that novels highlighting Black male oppression of Black females while downplaying white racist oppression of Black people would be more marketable than the reverse. Certainly, the diverse, inventive retelling of gender conflict between Black women and men, though often striking and deeply moving, rarely suggests oppositional aesthetic directions and possibilities. They are most often new takes on old themes. Interesting in that they call attention to the need for visionary, imaginative works that expand our notions of self and identity as they themselves often do not. They point to the way our struggle for subjectivity has too long been mired in heterosexism, a narrative of selfhood contained within a paradigm of coupled relationships. Even so, the realm of cultural production continues to be the location for possible transformative thinking about the nature of Black experience. It is no mere accident of fate that the ground of current discourse on Black subjectivity is cultural terrain. Art remains that site of imaginative possibility where anything goes, particularly if one is not seeking to create a hot commodity for the marketplace. Black folks' inability to envision liberatory paradigms of Black subjectivity in a purely political realm is in part a failure of critical imagination. Yet even on cultural ground, discussions of Black subjectivity are often limited to the topic of representation, good and bad images, or contained by projects concerned with reclaiming and or inventing traditions, expressed in literary circles by the issue of canon formation. Interestingly, both these endeavors are not in any essential way oppositional. Focus on good and bad images may be more fundamentally connected to the Western metaphysical dualism that is the philosophical underpinning of racist and sexist domination than with radical efforts to reconceptualize Black cultural identities. Concurrently, focus on canon formation legitimates the creative work of Black writers in academic circles while reinforcing white hegemonic authorial canonicity. Perhaps the most fascinating constructions of Black subjectivity and critical thinking about the same emerge from writers, cultural critics, and artists who are poised on the margins of various endeavors. I locate myself with this group, imagining I reside there with a wild crowd of known and unknown folks. We share commitment to left politics. Yes, we critique capitalism and explore the revolutionary possibilities of socialism. We are concerned with ending domination in all its forms. We are into reading and deeply concerned with aesthetics. I mean, I have my own bumper sticker firmly stuck on my heart. I die for style. We are into all kinds of culture and do not fear losing our Blackness. We see ourselves as one of the people, while simultaneously acknowledging our privileges, whatever they may be. Some of us are from working-class backgrounds, which makes our struggle for radical Black subjectivity unique and intense, because we have no intention of breaking ties with the world we come from. We all recognize the primacy of identity politics as an important stage in liberation process. We quote Audre Lorde, who said, "The master's tools will never dismantle the master's house," to claim the ground on which we are constructing home place. And we are not talking about ghettos or shanty towns. We are concerned about the fate of the planet, and some of us believe that living simply is part of revolutionary political practice. We have a sense of the sacred. The ground we stand on is shifting, fragile, and unstable. We are avant-garde only to the extent that we eschew essentialist notions of identity and fashion selves that emerge from the meeting of diverse epistemologies, habits of being, concrete class locations, and radical political commitments. We believe in solidarity and are working to make spaces where Black women and men can dialogue about everything, spaces where we can engage in critical dissent without violating one another, We are concerned with Black culture and Black identity. Cultural identity has become an uncool issue in some circles. One of the very crowd I mentioned earlier suggests the emphasis on culture is a sign of political defeat, whereas it seems to me a practical gesture to shift the scene of action if, in fact, the location of one's political practice does not enable change. We return to identity and culture for relocation, linked to political practice. Identity that is not informed by a narrow cultural nationalism masking continued fascination with the power of the white hegemonic other. Instead, identity is evoked as a stage in a process wherein one constructs radical Black subjectivity. Recent critical reflections on static notions of Black identity urge transformation of our sense of who we can be and still be Black. Assimilation, imitation, or assuming the role of rebellious exotic other are not the only available options and never have been. This is why it is crucial to radically revise notions of identity politics to explore marginal locations as spaces where we can best become whatever we want to be while remaining committed to liberatory Black liberation struggle. A similar effort is taking place within feminist theory, where an identity politics based on essentialism is critiqued, while the connection between identity and politics is affirmed. Linda Alcoff problematizes it this way in her essay, Cultural Feminism versus Post-Structuralism, The Identity Crisis in Feminist Theory. Identity politics provides a decisive rejoinder to the generic human thesis in the mainstream methodology of Western political theory. If we combine the concept of identity politics with a conception of the subject as positionality, we can conceive of the subject as non-essentialized and emergent from a historical experience. Such a standpoint would enable Black folks to move away from narrow notions of Black identity, assertions of identity that bring complexity and variety to constructions of Black subjectivity are often negated by conservative policing forces, that is, Black people who dismiss differences among us by labeling some folks Black and others not. Growing up, whenever I thought about life in ways that differed from my familiar status quo, from our segregated Black community norms, I was called Miss White Girl. This process of social excommunication from Blackness extends far beyond households. Folks who are concerned with preserving stereotypical identities can be most vicious in their condemnation of someone as not Black. Still, confronting these stereotypical forces, which do not ever want to call attention to more fluid notions of Black identity or to marginal perspectives, is not nearly as frustrating as confrontation with the white avant-garde in politically charged cultural contexts, in which they seek to appropriate and usurp radical efforts to subvert static notions of Black identity. Such appropriation happens again and again. It takes the form of constructing African-American culture as though it exists solely to suggest new aesthetic and political directions white folks might move in. Michelle Wallace calls it seeing African-American culture as the starting point for white self-criticism. An example which readily comes to mind from feminist movement centers on efforts made by women of color to call attention to white racism in the struggle, as well as talking about racial identity from a standpoint which deconstructs the category woman. Such discussions were part of the struggle by women of color to come to voice, and also to assert new and different feminist narratives. Many white feminists responded by hearing only what was being said about race, and most specifically about racism. Focusing solely on the issue of racism allowed for a recentering of white authorial presence. White feminists could now centralize themselves by engaging in a discourse on race, the other, in a manner which further marginalized women of color, whose works were often relegated to the realm of the experiential. In actuality, the theoretical groundwork for all reconsiderations of the category woman, which consider race, as talked about in the work of theorists like Teresa de la Ruretis and Elizabeth Spelman and many others, was laid by women of color. Among white feminist theoretical elites in the United States, the work of women of color is usually cited solely in relation to discussions of race. Our work is subordinated and used to reinforce their assertions about race and otherness. Certainly my book, Feminist Theory, From Margin to Center, did not focus centrally on race, yet it is usually cited as though that was the most talked about subject. Radical Black subjectivity can be recognized by others without ongoing political resistance only in a context where white people and third world elites are not trying to maintain cultural hegemony, insisting that we be as they want us to be. Such contexts are rare. Recently, I heard Cornel West give a moving, insightful lecture, Decentering Europe, the Crisis of Contemporary Culture. Though highly intellectual and theoretical in content, his manner of presentation was akin to a sermon mode popular in Black communities, where such a style indicates depth and seriousness. In the context of white institutions, particularly universities, that mode of address is questionable precisely because it moves people. Style is equated in such a setting with a lack of substance. West not only transformed social space, legitimating an aspect of Black experience in a context which rarely recognizes the value of Black culture, he was also able to include non-scholarly members of the audience. His style of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.